ஓம் சதாசிவ சமாரம்பாம் சங்கராச்சாரிய மத்தியமாம் அஸ்மதாச்சாரிய பரியந்தாம் வந்தே குரு பரம்பராம். ஸோ எஸ்டர்டே வி சா அபவுட் த பர்பஸ் ஆஃப் யோகா அண்ட் வேதாந்தா, அண்ட் டுடே ஐ செட் வீல் ஸ்பீக் அபவுட் த சாதனா. வாட் யூ சப்போஸ் டு டூ? ஐம் ஷூர் யூ ஃபெமிலியர் வித் த டேர்ம் சாதனா. டு டூ வாட் இஸ் டு? ஜஸ்ட் டு கிளாரிஃபை, டெக்னிக்கலி சாத்யா is the means, is the end. Sadhya, in Sanskrit when you use the word sadhya, what do you want to achieve? I want to go to the food court. Sadhya, sadhana is the means for going, getting there. Oh, here you just walk across, so walking will become the sadhana. The sadhaka is the person who is adopting the means, sadhana, to reach the sadhya, to reach the end. Siddha is a person who has achieved the end. All those guys sitting down there and having their meal, they're siddhas, okay? Because they got it. So very often we look at, now what is it that decides the sadhana? Does the person decide it or does the sadhya decide it? What do you think? I mean, we all would like to feel, hey, I decide my sadhana. The sadhya decides it. I have to reach there, sadhya. Now, in the sadhana, I may have a few choices. You can walk, you can roll. If there is a bicycle around, you can use that. But your choices are limited to these. I can't take a car there because not allowed here, not allowed there. I may want to, but I can't. I can't fly. So my choice as far as the sadhana is concerned is limited to what the sadhya is. If the sadhya is appeasing my hunger, sadhana is food and drink. Now what food and drink, you have a choice there. Now, I don't like any of this. You know, I have this wonderful cookbook. It's got so many recipes, nothing is available there. Okay, eat the cookbook. But your choices are limited to that. Because you can't make all those things here. It's not available here. Are you getting the idea? The sadhya decides the sadhana. So within the options of sadhana, you have some choice. Depending upon where you are, what you need. That's why mastery of the mind is the sadhana, is the sadhya in yoga. The purpose, we said, that's the sadhya. Mastery of the mind. Chitta vritti nirodha. Sadhana, as far as yoga is concerned, is the eightfold path. Eight steps. Yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, dharana, dhyana, samadhi. Which we saw a little bit elaborately yesterday. So do you have any questions or anything that you want me to clarify about this part of it? The eightfold aspects of yoga. This is really speaking Ashtanga yoga, okay? The Ashtanga yoga has become a separate branch of yoga. Really speaking, Ashtanga, when you say, all the eight steps are there. Ashta Angaha. Ashta meaning eight, Angaha meaning parts, limbs. So everything you do is to master your mind step by step. You have a certain universal value structure put in, Yama Niyama. Take it now as universal ethics. Though one among them can be a bit of a confusion. Brahmacharya. Celibacy? Hey, you are asking me to be celibate. Come on. In today's world, I am only 18. What celibacy are you talking about? Life awaits. Correct, life awaits. It is not celibacy. Brahmacharya literally means Brahma Marge Yo Charati. who is moving on the part of Brahman. So whoever is on the spiritual part is called a brahmachari. So brahmacharya is being spiritual and disciplined sex. Yeah, sex disciplined. So not too much of it. What do you mean not too much? I mean, too much is a vague term, no? Too little. At 70, you may say once a week is enough. At 18, how many times a day? What do you mean? I mean, come on, we all been there, done that, you know? So it's okay, to be honest. Just because I'm wearing this dress doesn't mean I'm away from life. So what is too much or what is too little? We have a simple guideline in yoga. At the end of the session that you have with your partner, and you had your cuddling and all after that, come on, that is as important. Hey, remember, I come from, my ancestors wrote the Kama Sutra, okay? So we know the, okay? So we know the whole thing, exactly what it is about. Yeah, in fact, we can help refine things. So at the end of it, when you're getting up to have a wash or a glass of water or whatever, if your knees are wobbly, it is too much. It is actually mentioned. All teachers tell their students this, okay? Traditional teachers will tell this. Modern teachers may not say. But people like us are traditional teachers who stand rooted in the tradition. We say this. Otherwise, how can you say what is too much? So if you're not fit, you may feel wobbly after one night session. If you're fit, yeah, so what is too much? Depends on what you are. Where are you? This, we are completely open to life. So as long as you're not feeling wobbly at the end of it, you are within limits. So a disciplined approach to it, that you don't overindulge in it. That's all. Disciplined. Yeah. You're not hopping from one person to the other, because then it creates its own psychological issues. So you have a committed relationship. Though it's okay, when you're 18, you may think, if you made a 6 months plan, it is committed. No? But that's okay, at least 6 months you're thinking of, it's okay. So I'm not talking about lifelong commitment, etc. Those days are gone. I don't know whether those days are ever there, okay? When I read the literature, Indian literature I'm talking about, traditional literature in Sanskrit. Yeah. Of course, when you fall in love, are you thinking you're going to be off in 5 years? No, you hope for it to last. You hope for it to last, though you're aware it may not. That's a healthy approach. You're aware it may not last. There may be an end to it, but you're hoping it'll last. That's a healthy approach to it. Yeah, that's a healthy approach. Yeah. So this is the only value structure which is universal, which may create some conflict, because the word is presented like that, celibacy. No, it's not celibacy. It is this, the disciplined approach to life. So you have the yama niyama, which forms the base, because there is some freedom from conflict in that. There is a structure. So the manasli mind is not conflicted. There is a base for it. Then you start with the body, as I said, to harness the mind. So your seat of the practice of meditation starts on the mat. Asanas. Pranayama for your energy work. At the same time, when you focus on pranayama, your mind quietens down. Dharana, learning to focus. The practice of samadhi, dhyana, and then slipping into it. This is complete mastery. Yesterday I was elaborating this a lot. Okay? So mastery of the mind is a sadhya in yoga. Therefore the sadhana is along with it. And since it's mastery of the mind, it can be done differently as well. Like, I have not practiced too much of yoga. Little bit I have done. My background came from a different discipline. But that's also about mastery of the mind. Okay. So it's all about mastery of the mind. So there are a lot of disciplines for it. Another thing that people in the West have heard about a lot, tantra. and the whole association with sex. Tantra is not about sex, it's about sexual control. You arouse yourself because the sexual energy or your yogic energy also is in the root chakra. So you arouse it and then you don't have sex. You don't climax. It can be frustrating. You're arousing yourself and you're not supposed to climax. Then you're supposed to transmute that energy. That's what Tantra is about. It's transmutation of that energy. So it can be more frustrating than a yogic lifestyle. Yeah, because you're arousing yourself and not getting satisfied. Come on here, what is this? Yeah, isn't it? I mean, I'm a pragmatic man. Before I became a monk, I was a sailor. Yeah, so you know what it's all about, yeah. And I come to England many times as a sailor, but that was years ago. So, all these things, all the myths going around, whatever it is, mastery of the mind, aim for that. So now, what should I do? You pick and choose what is important for you. Your body is troubling you too much, maybe you need more asanas. Your mind and energy is going haywire, do more pranayamas. Yeah. In fact, I personally would focus a lot more on pranayamas than the simple asanas. Yeah. Pranayamas. Dharana, learning to focus. Yeah. Learning to be awareful. Mindfulness, etc. That's part of the yogic practice. To be awareful wherever. One simple thing would be to be awareful wherever you are. Whatever you are doing. It's a great practice. Awareful of your choice of words. So you don't have to tell your partner, sorry, I didn't mean that. We say that all the time. Then after that, whatever you say is not taken seriously. Because three times before you said, sorry, I didn't mean, sorry, I didn't mean, sorry. Then you're looking nice. He didn't mean that. He doesn't mean anything anyway. Be very awareful of what you say. So that you don't have to take a statement made, doesn't have to be taken back. You stand by it. A big discipline is a bigger discipline than we think it is. It's about dharana. About being paying attention to your thinking and your saying. Yeah. To live by what you know, integrity. Big sadhana. It is put as satyam in yama niyamas. What is satyam? To live by what you know. Yeah. What I know and what I live, but very often we don't. I know. See, if I was a person of integrity and I keep smoking, because I didn't know the harmful effects of smoking, and now I discovered it, what should happen? My fingers should open, the cigarette should drop. That's it. I smoked my last cigarette. Why? Integrity. Thinking, knowledge, emotions, behavior is in harmony. I mean, that doesn't mean I have to say everything I think about someone or something. But if I say it, it is in harmony. I don't have to go and tell an idiot he's an idiot. Yeah, so I keep quiet. I don't have to go about calling people anything. That's being judgmental. So even if I think, I don't have to say it. But I can't call him a very wise person when I think he's an idiot. That will be in contradiction to my integrity. That's what creates too many splits in our personalities. Too much of fragmentation. Because of all the white lies that we are supposed to say socially. I know some of it we cannot avoid. Some of it we cannot avoid, I know that. Especially if you are in a relationship. Small white lies are important. Since the men are in a minority, I'll give the example of a man. Your partner, a woman, comes and asks you, do I look fat in this? What do you say? Whatever you say, you are in trouble. Whatever you say, you will be in trouble. Yeah. No, you look a little. You think I look fat. You are always critical about me, okay? Why are you body shaming me? Hey, I think you look great. You never tell me honestly what it is. Then her friend, best friend comes in. Yeah, doesn't suit you, look fat. See, why couldn't you say that? You're telling me why I didn't say that? My God. I don't want to be killed. Jokes apart, okay? But, so some white lies we have to say. I'm just giving an example for some white lies. Okay? But that apart, those things apart, to live a life of integrity, all this is part of the game. The sadhana and yoga, that's how you master your mind. Yeah. And all the way. So any questions on any of these disciplines? Because it's a huge topic. So are you having any questions on any of these? Yama niyama always up to samadhi. Yes. I'm sorry, I'm very hard of hearing. Even in spite of my hearing aid, I'm hard of hearing. So, can someone just sum up the sitting closer, sum up that question for me so that I understand it better?
I think question in the knowledge, emotion and behavior.
Yeah, knowledge and behavior, right?
Yeah, knowledge, emotion, behavior.
Yeah, to integrate that. It's actually very simple, you know. Look at how we were as a child. We were taught about, let us say, a simple hygienic thing. Don't eat anything fallen on the ground. As a child, I didn't know that. I only obliged my mother. She told me, don't. Okay. It's all covered with germs. Okay. I didn't really understand. But I obliged. So if I knew she was not looking, which child will not pick up a chocolate that's fallen on the ground? You are not a child if you don't do that. So it is natural. Then as you grew up, you went to school, you learned about hygiene, you learned about germs, you learned about infection, all that you learned. Now we won't think twice. No? Now we won't think twice. Something is fallen, so it goes into the garbage straight. Why? Because it has been integrated into us. So that integration requires a lot of understanding plus my heart accepting what my head knows. I really have to understand this. Otherwise, I'll say, no, no, 5-second rule. Now, the 5-second rule is applicable if it falls in your home on the counter, which is clean. If it falls there, it doesn't require 5 seconds. It requires half a second or a nanosecond. So the 5-second rule is not applicable there. Any home is applicable. So it is not that it is hard and fast. It's not that it's absolute. It's relative. So you follow that. So the heart understands. The emotions are trained. Hey, come on. Like how Rumba, as a child, when we first discovered about germs and things like that, it is not that immediately it happened. My emotional thing had to follow and so on. Then once the thinking and not knowing and emotions follow, then the physical thing is easy. It is the emotions that pull us here and there, which is natural, that's human, and that's beautiful also. So it goes. So once you do that, you're fine. Have I clarified? Yeah. Okay. Any other questions on anything that we have done? The whole thing. Right? Yeah.
I mean, I think you said it when you said Brahmacharya was being disciplined in things.
See, it also changes, you know. A youngster is experimenting a bit and things like that. That's okay. You're not expecting a youngster to be a yogi. You're not expecting an 18-year-old to be a yogi. Eh? Though there have been yogis at 18. That's from previous lifetimes, etc. So that little bit of experimentation is natural. Let us humans, fine. It's okay. One has to be large-hearted enough to accept that. Yeah. I mean, I run a youth group in Bombay, and Bombay is no different from any of the cities here. And youngsters have a greater freedom in Bombay because commuting, they don't have to depend on anyone. Here, you depend on your parents for commuting. Even at 14, 15, you depend on your parents to drop you here, drop you. Bombay, there's a great amount of independence because public transport is very good. They can hop into a bus, hop into a rake, hop into a train. It's easy. So they have greater freedom that way. So Bombay is not different from... So my kids will come and talk to me about all sorts of stuff. And I'm very accepting about it. Because I know I've been a kid myself. So it's okay. I turned out fine. In fact, when I start the youth group, new people come in, I tell them this. Hey, all that you fantasize about doing, I've already done. Been there, done that. I turned out fine. I'm sure all of you will turn out fine. If you live by certain, you know, you learn to direct your life and get some guidance, all of you will turn out fine. And this I'll tell you all the parents here also. Our kids will never fail us if we don't fail them. Never. I don't think there's anything wrong with any kid. They're great kids. They do well. May require a little bit of guidance here and there. Not in the form of advice. No. In the form of other things, of logic and discussion and things like that. And if you're a parent, they'll push you. And if you have a parent, you're supposed to push back and put certain rules. I, as a, what they call me, as a Swami uncle, can afford to be more relaxed with them. Because I'm not their parent. I'm their confidant. So I can be more relaxed. Yeah. Plus, my gray hairs have earned, so I know that they'll be okay. They'll be okay. Yeah, because I've seen their parents also go through the same thing, so no big deal. That's okay. Yeah. So the parents have come and complained to me when they were young. Now their kids are coming and complaining to me. I said, full circle now, okay? Now it's your turn to be at the end of the complaining. I listen to them. When you were young, I listened to you. Now I listen to them. So my life is fine that way. And they all be fine. That's okay. So some of this thing happens when you're young. It's okay. To learn from it and move on. Then you're okay. Yeah. I mean, we all done things like that. Yeah, we all done. So it's okay. So when this practice, that mastery comes in, as I was saying to the end of yesterday's talk, you get into that mastery and then you're ready. Now, what is the sadhana in Vedanta? Because Vedanta is very peculiar. Where is the journey? From you to yourself. Okay. The journey ends where it begins. In between you cover a lot of ground. So in Vedanta, the whole idea is about understanding who you are. Knowing the truth about yourself. Because I am born with ignorance. Ignorance is the capital with which I am born. All of us, the ordinary person on the road, the wisest of the wise, all of us, we are born with total ignorance. Ignorance about myself, ignorance about the world. Even my mom, I'm ignorant of. She was just a friendly heartbeat that made me feel calm. And when I came out, she's my food, source of food, sustenance, nurturance. That's all I know about my mother, nothing else. I don't know anything about myself. Haven't you seen babies looking at their hand and wondering what it is? Their feet, and they'll take their toe and put it in the mouth. Because that's the most developed sense organ, not their eyes. Because they have to eat to survive, I mean drink to survive. Their mouth is the most developed sense organ, so everything goes into the mouth. And it's funny, I'm finding sensation here. When I put this into my mouth, I'm finding sensation only here. But when I put my finger in, I'm finding sensation here, sensation there. Oh, that must be also me. That's how they start. That's how the babies start. Watch them, watch a baby. Yeah, maybe. So ignorance about myself, ignorance about the world. And as I live, I keep shedding ignorance. I'm spending ignorance. The capital with which I came. I shed the ignorance about the world. I understand who my mother is, my father is, who my siblings, uncles, aunt, all that loud sounding uncle who comes and pinches me on my cheeks, they're supposed to be uncle. Yeah. So I keep understanding. I keep understanding a little bit more of the body and etc. Then as I become an adult, I understand more about the body. If you're a yoga into yoga, you'll understand much more about the body, the mind, all that you understand. But the ignorance about your true self, that's quietly sitting in your heart. It's quietly sitting in your mind. I can go to the moon and come back, and the self-ignorance can be there. Next stop, Mars, okay. I can go to Mars and come back. Come back, not yet very clear. Going is clear, one-way trip. Coming back is not yet clear. So, but I can go and come back. And the ignorance will continue. Self-ignorance, because I never paid attention to it. So what? Look at it. All of us want to be a fulfilled being. What are we doing, anything that we are doing for? For the sake of happiness, fulfillment. And when I'm young, I start with thinking, happiness is out there. Have you heard about that Viking, Hagar the Horrible? It comes as a comic strip. So he's telling his wife, Helga, I'm going to Europe. Do you want anything from there? Oh, she's drinking her tea. If you go to France, you might as well pick up some culture. Out comes the sword. Don't worry, baby. If they have got it, I will get it. You can't get culture like that. So how are you going to get self-knowledge? No? All of us want fulfillment. And we think fulfillment is out there. When you are young, it is all out there. And it takes some life. You say, yeah, it is there, but it doesn't last. The joy doesn't last. Oh, the relationship was wonderful. Not going anywhere. A very common complaint I hear. It's not going anywhere. Where do you expect it to go? Are you happy with each other? Are you supportive of each other? Are you fine, physically intimate with each other? Yes. What are you expecting then? Oh, it's not moving. Okay, where do you want to move? To get married. Are you sure? Oh, yeah. Okay. Then it is going somewhere. Where is the question? Where is the question? Like I was staying with a couple. They've been married 20 years. Very good marriage. And she is going earlier for work. He was going a bit later. So he said, okay, good. Okay, I'll see you in the evening. I said, what? Are you not going to kiss her goodbye? I will walk out to the next room. But you better kiss her goodbye. Oh, we have been married 20 years. I said, so? Now you know where it is going. I said, so what if we are married 20 years? You got kids? So? You wanted it to go, but where is it going? So, why? Because after a certain amount, that just becomes a nice, comfortable thing. Natural. This guy complains to me about his job. I said, there's no job satisfaction. Big thing. I said, no job satisfaction. He said, first thing, is the job paying you well? Because that's first. Oh yeah, it's good. Money is good. Are you learning new things, growing in your job? Yes. Are you have good colleagues? Yeah, good team. Good boss? Yes. Good juniors? Yes. Hey, you have an ideal job. What is not getting satisfaction? You don't get this in any job, do you, wrongly? All this I mentioned? You don't. If you get about 3-4 of them, you should be very happy in that job. But no satisfaction. You know why? Because the heart is empty. You're looking for a sense of fulfillment. Whether it's a relationship, whether it's work, whether it's achievement. I want to gain money, I want to be one of the billionaires. Then after you're a billionaire, what next? Now start giving it away. Bill Gates. Why? Now there is joy in sharing and giving. Why did you accumulate in the first place? So many people went bankrupt because to make you rich. Why couldn't you let them be? Why you gained the money and now you say, I want to give it away? Because anything will give you a certain amount of joy. None of it will last. Because your self-judgment about yourself is, as I am not happy. I'm self-awareful enough to know this, that as I am, things are not well. So I'm always postponing my happiness to that better job, to that better house, to that better relationship, to that better whatever. As a child, it was one more chocolate. As an adult, it may be one more house, one more car, one more whatever. Yeah. Like there is this, I don't want to name places because that may seem judgmental or not politically correct. I went to this festival. It is a very fun social thing. And when I travel, I like to see everything. You know, what's happening, local culture. So there is this habit. If you're single, you will wear one feather in your hat. If you're married, it's two. Some people wear three. I'm with someone, but I'm still available. I'm not joking, guys. I'm not mentioning places. Because you're happy with, yeah, I'm happy, but what? You're expecting more than what the relationship can give you. You're expecting more than what the job can give you. You're expecting more than what the house can give you. You're wanting, the heart wants it, and that's genuine. Don't fool yourself by all the songs that you have in England of contentment and everything. Oh, I studied a lot of that English poetry. Oh, sweet content. And what is that other one? What is this life full of care? We have no time to stand and stare. No time to stand beneath the boughs and stare as long as sheep and cows. And I'm thinking, why do I want to stare like a sheep and a cow? I want to stare as a human being. I mean, England has some wonderful poetry. And I still love that English poetry. I still love. As poetry, I still love. But some of them, like contentment, etc., I don't. What are the other favorite? Daffodils. I don't know whether you'll still read all this in schools and colleges. But we did. Of course, that was a long time back. The dancing daffodils and all that. All these poems which talk about a contentment which human beings don't achieve. And if you have kids, never talk to them about contentment. He'll come with barely passing grades and say, I'm content with it. What is your passing grade? C plus? D? What is it? D plus. Okay. He'll come with D plus. Why not an A? But mama, I'm content with D plus. Whether you've got D plus or A, you passed the year, no? That's fine. But then what's the thing about learning to achieve and things like that? I'm spiritual. No? What spiritual? You're being an idiot, not being spiritual. The contentment doesn't exist. Except temporarily. That you can always feel. After a nice meal, and you're standing and looking out, all is well with the world. Until I start feeling sleepy and say, I want a cup of coffee. So we are looking for a certain fulfillment which is not completely available anywhere. And that is because of our self-judgment that I am not fine as I am. That is based on my ignorance about what I am. Just imagine, okay? Who's a famous British actor right now? Give me one name.
Roger Moore,
okay. Let us say this man. He's a movie actor?
Yeah.
Okay. And all movie actors, once to perform on the stage, because that's where real acting comes out, you know? Because no retakes, nothing. So he's acting on the stage. It's a Anglo-Indian production. So some of the Bollywood influences are there. So he's supposed, and he's playing the role of a beggar. He's dressed like a beggar. He's supposed to go to this restaurant, and the guy's supposed to push him out and says, no, no beggars allowed. And he's supposed to fall down. And because of that Bollywood influence, he's supposed to get up and break into a song. What does the world know and what does the world care and all that thing. This is the thing. Okay. So it has been going smoothly, very nicely. And he can play the role of a beggar because he knows he's going to be rich at the end of the day. Rich in experience, rich in the money is being paid, everything. Today the push is a little bit harder than what that guy planned to. And he falls hard, hits his head on the ground. For a second he's unconscious. Just a second. Then he gets up looking dazed. And the people are thinking, wow, what realistic acting. And then he has forgotten, who am I, what am I? Today, do you think a song will come out? He'll be looking at himself and saying, I'm dressed as a beggar. And that guy just get lost. I'm being treated as a beggar. I must be a beggar. But I'm not happy with that. Look at it. The conclusion is, I'm a beggar because I'm dressed like one and people are treating like one. I'm a human being. People are treating me like a human being, but somewhere I'm dissatisfied. This is our lot. This is our human lot. That vague sense of dissatisfaction that is there constantly, even when life is going fine. When life is not going fine, dissatisfaction is natural. But even when life is going fine, something, you know, something, what is missing? I'm missing something. Maybe I should travel. The same monkey mind that's going anyway, so the monkey mind will remain monkey mind. No, but I have a mastered mind. My mind listens to exactly what I say. But this vague sense of dissatisfaction, drop it. That's something the mind cannot drop because it's innate. That is your spiritual urge coming out. That really speaking is a deep-suited, fundamental spiritual urge which everyone has but few recognize. Everyone has this. Youngsters more. Why? That angst of teenagers, it comes up a lot until it gets buried in the business of life. Because living is not easy. You have to earn your living, you have to do this, you have to do that, look after kids. It's not easy. So you're so busy with all that, this gets buried under. It gets buried under. And even in youngsters, even though the angst is felt strong, the thirst for enjoying life and experiencing life, which is normal and which is good, comes along. So this gets buried inside. This urge is what Vedanta addresses. Now you've mastered your mind behaves. Now come and understand exactly who you are. So since the self is shrouded in ignorance, I don't know, obviously the solution is in terms of knowledge. So the primary sadhana, the means in Vedanta, the primary means is knowing, knowledge. Now to know, you require a means of knowledge. To know this pen, you require your eyes. There is no knowledge, worldly or spiritual, which you can get without a means of knowledge. So, in Vedanta, the primary means become go to a teacher and study, learn. Because the means for knowing the self is what we call under a generic term, Vedanta. It's, or as the speaker in the morning was saying, Advaita Vedanta, as general. But just listening, words can convey the truth? Yes, it can. It's not intuition or anything. Words reveal the truth. How many of you, they were in the morning talks? Most of you? Okay, some of you. Really. Okay, so a lot of it is covered. Good, I will go over it just for those who are not there. And I will show you how words can reveal the truth. It doesn't require your intuition. Words will reveal it. What did he start with by saying? I think, who am I? I think I am this body. But we have enough experiences to show I am independent of the body as well. My own experiences. Remember? My body. Oh, I went to the, what a Ashtanga yoga workout I had yesterday. My whole body is sore. My whole body, mine. Is there experience? I and mine cannot be the same. So we have this mind. And the simple logic, when you have a doubt like this, two different experiences, I and mind, they are different. We have to use some logic. The logic is simple. What you are conscious of, what you are aware of, you are different from. Let's keep stick to the basic, one simple logic. Are you aware of this body? In fact, you go to a doctor and say, I have a backache. Oh, do these tests, x-rays, is that. Everything is normal. You're fine. But doctor, I have the pain. Can the doctor say you don't have pain? It's my body. I know where it's aching. I can pinpoint here. This. Oh, it's postural. Do some yoga. Good solution. For 90% of the backaches, it works. 10% is psychosomatic. So okay. Or rather, 5% is psychosomatic. 5% there is some other reason. So my body, I'm aware of it, independent of it. My mind, emotions, etc. Of course, I'm aware of it. I'm feeling like this now, I felt like that earlier, I felt like this. I'm aware of all those things. I'm aware of it, I'm independent of the mind. Mind, intellect, knowledge. You are there to gather that knowledge. You are there to handle your reasoning. You are there to correct your reasoning, to go in different lines. So you are aware of that. You are different from that. Then he said about Anandamaya Kosha. Anandamaya Kosha is also ignorance. Any experience of joy is Anandamaya. Ignorance. That you are aware of. Does anybody here know Russian language? Oh, you do? Okay. Then I have to use some other word. Does anyone here know Croatian? No. Are you aware of your ignorance of Croatian? Yeah. So you are aware of your ignorance as well. When you are happy, you are aware of that happiness, happy experience as well. So the Anandamaya, or that is your not. Then what are you? Here is where Vedanta comes in very. Look at it, words. Listen to these words. You are that awareful being who is aware of everything? Yeah. So you are that awareer, the one who is aware of everything with respect to everything. With respect to yourself, what are you? You have to be the abstract form of the same awareness or consciousness. Okay. I am conscious. Okay, fine. So what? In what way does that make me limitless? Here it is. What is the biggest conditionings you have in life that makes you a finite entity? Time and space. Limited by time and space. So here is, look, all these are Vedantic arguments, okay? I may use some argument from science to come in just to help you all understand it easier. What is this thing that we call time? Especially in a country that has clock adjustments, so you change the time. So in science, we define time as the gap between two events. This definition holds from time immemorial. The gap between two events is time. In olden days, sunrise and sunset was time. It was the two events, a good measure, especially in tropical countries, because they more or less were equal. Didn't change much. 45 minutes difference between winter and summer, that's all. Whereas here, between winter and summer, there are 3 hour difference. So that was the measure, which was fine in an agrarian society, because we are in agriculture, etc. Whether it was 7 o'clock or 7:30 that you went, it didn't make a difference. So the two events, sunrise, sunset, then we started dividing it because we wanted more finer measurements. So in traditional Indian thing, we divided it into 3 hour slots. Each slot was called a Yamaha. We needed more accurate. We divided into Muhurtas. One Muhurta roughly equates to 1 hour. Then Ghatikas, etc., which corresponds to your minutes, etc. Then milliseconds, nanoseconds. So the division was based on observation, to the gap between two. The latest, when most of you are wearing quartz watches, so the gap between two pulses of a quartz, the event from sunrise sunset became gap between two pulses. So what has got time to do with myself? Everything. Again, let me use the scientific this, which traditionally also we say the same thing. He says, is there an event without an observer? The fundamental principle in science is there is no event without an observer. The popular philosophical question, if a tree falls in the forest and nobody heard it, did it fall? Good to think about it. Okay. There is no event without an observer. So the two pulses of the chords are two events became two observations. That means the two events are reduced to two thoughts. What is there between two thoughts? Don't say nothing. Me, the conscious being, who's aware of the thoughts. Therefore, when you look at me, when I look at myself, the consciousness, through this gap of events, which is gap of thoughts, I get this idea of time. I am the truth of time. Time doesn't condition me. I, consciousness, is the base of time. That's why you can have an aging body. Body can age differently for different people. You share a yogi, much less. Can it age your mind? You can have a tired mind. I've been there, done that, so many things, hurt, pain, guilt, anger, so I'm tired. Or you can have an enthusiastic mind, but there's no aging mind. So it can't even affect your mind. What about it affecting me, the one who's aware of that whole concept of time? Time is nothing but looking at myself through this flow of thoughts. The gap between thoughts is what we call time. That's why in sleep, you dismiss thoughts, there is no time. In samadhi, you dismiss thoughts, there is no time. So does time condition me, the consciousness? No way. If I dismiss time, I dismiss space as well. Because time-space continuum is one. Thanks to Stephen Hawking, that's well proved, well documented. Our Upanishads talk about the same. Either we'll talk about time or we'll talk about space. We'll never talk about both. Why? One is there, the other is understood. Even your experience. Can you think of here without now? Or there, then? It's connected up right there. How far away from here are you? 20-minute drive. Huh? I asked how far you're talking time. They're interchangeable units, sir. Can you see that? Okay, let us look at another way. How do you know space? Tell me, how do you see space? All of us know space. All of us have seen space, isn't it? How do you see it?
The gap between us.
Huh?
The gap between us.
That is because you can see. What about a blind person?
They can sense it.
He senses it. If you close your eyes, are you still aware of space? You see space exactly like how you see a concept, how you see an emotion, without the necessity of a sense organ. In Sanskrit, we call it Sakshi Vetyam, directly known to me, the awareer, without the necessity of a sense organ. You love this person. Do you need a sense organ to know that? You see, it's in your mind. The affection is there in your mind. You see it directly. You know you love this person. You know you can't stand this guy. Why? It's all here. How do you see space? Same way. No sense organ involved. People are born blind. No space. Very interesting. So really speaking, space is seen here, but seen out as though it's outside. Because there's very little difference between inside and outside, really speaking. Because when we think of space, we think it's all out there. What about here? Before my lunch? Lot of space, no? And if we are not understanding that, there's a lot of space here. More than necessary. So can you see that? This is it. So you, the consciousness, unconditioned by time and space. Have you used any intuition here or anything else? You're directly knowing it. The Taittiriya Upanishad, it doesn't remain silent on that fact of consciousness. After that Anandamaya, he says, Brahma Puchyam Pratishtam. Brahman is the basis of the whole thing, he says. Anandamaya Kosha also, Brahman is the basis. Atma is the basis for everything. It doesn't remain silent. It's very eloquent. But one small line that many people can miss. Brahma Puchyam Pratishtam. Brahman is the basis for the whole thing, he says. So all your, from your unconscious onwards to the body, everything, what is the basis for the whole thing? That I, yourself, that conscious being. Basis for the whole thing. This understanding, I have put it in a nutshell. I have students who have been learning from me for years, the same thing. Because it takes some time for understanding. Nuances, etc., take some time. So, this is the primary sadhana in Vedanta, is this. Listening. Then, of course, you have doubts coming up. But I heard this here. In Buddhism, this is what I heard. I heard this. My experience is this. Lot of doubts can throw up. Either from my own thinking or somebody else's thinking. Handling those doubts through reason, because the mind understands the language of reason. Otherwise, what do you expect? To understand the language of unreason or illogic? No, reasoning. So you reason out and clarify your doubts, etc., either by yourself, with other students around, or with the help of a teacher. It can run all the way around. That is called mananam in Sanskrit, reflection, to reflect upon what you heard so that it is free from all doubt and vagueness. Then another problem can come up. What is that? My meat and potatoes thinking. What is meat and potatoes thinking? Let me illustrate this with an example. Where I stay back in Mumbai, there's a marketplace. So in that marketplace, there was this beggar. He was probably born there and lived all his life as a beggar. Okay. So he used to beg around and people will give him something and he would live. In Bombay, begging can be a profession as well. Oh yeah. So this was his life. He was going on happy. Then, before the celebration of Diwali, there was this bumper lotteries. You have lotteries in UK also? You must be having. You can't. Oh yeah, they're the one who took over the rail service and everything. Nah? Oh yeah. When railways got privatized. Yeah. So the lotteries, he won the bumper prize. 25 crores of Indian rupees. That even after taxes will come to about 12.5, 13 crores. They'll come to how much? 1 million would be about seven, a few million. Let us say a few million pounds. That's rich, well off. Not rich, but well off enough. So, new house. Bought a house. New house. New car. New clothes. New wife. Oh, sorry, not new wife. Same wife, but now legalized, married, because now middle class morality has come in. And you know how the newer rich are, no? Gold rings and all. Because he has to feel rich, you know? Then now he knows. Now he drove this nice new car into the marketplace. Why? He wanted to show all those people that, hey, now I'm well off, I'm no more a beggar. And there is a small temple in that marketplace, where on some days they distribute some food for the poor. And it was one of those days. Remember, 30 years of experience as a beggar. Food distribution, what happens to him? Over the heads and shoulders of everybody else, his hand goes first. Why? 30 years experience, remember? And that guy drops that. And he's seeing all these golden rings, the golden watch. And he looks surprised because this is meant for the poor, not for you. In that man's eyes, this guy says, oh my God, what have I done? Feel sheepish. What happened to him? Was he not aware he's rich? He knew. Yeah, but the old conditionings came back. Breaking these conditionings is called Nididhyasanam, contemplation in Vedanta. Probably tomorrow I can make you all do some of that also. Yeah, one more day, there's a lot of time. You know? So, this is the primary sadhana in Vedanta. Listening to a teacher where knowledge takes place, clarifying the doubts, etc. Meditation to own up. All this will work only in a prepared mind. If the person is coming without a disciplined mind, I'm talking about, you know, you're that consciousness, this, that, you're not the body, you're not that. I'm not the body. He hears the word body. Oh, somebody was called, that actress was called the body. His mind is gone there. I gave an example, the mind is gone there. I've come back to the topic, gone, his mind is there. No, no discipline, no focus. His focus requires some more focus. He can't sit and listen too much. What is disturbing him too much? Hey, I want a cup of coffee. Yeah, after a few minutes we'll have a break. Coffee. So with that indisciplined mind, or he's sitting there, sitting in my class, come to listen about the fulfilled self. That girl looks so beautiful here. Common interest. Can I ask for a phone number afterwards? How do I approach her? He's thinking of that. I'm talking about the Atman and he's thinking about the girl sitting next to him. Can you see? There's nothing wrong. Go ask her a number afterwards. If I know her, I'll introduce you to her. No problems. I mean, that's normal life, but that normal life here is different. You come for a different purpose. Are you getting that idea? So that indisciplined mind, that non-mastered mind cannot get it. So yoga, the mastery, very important. Without mastered mind, if you come to Vedanta, it doesn't work. Because you don't get half the things I'm saying. Yeah. You don't get half the things. It's like, oh, I asked, who's that actor? Oh, I like George Clooney. He's so cute. Mind has gone there. What am I saying? Mind has gone to the... You know, this happens. It's normal. Therefore, that disciplining. When that happens, you're fine. I think I'm supposed to stop at 3, right? At 3 o'clock? Yeah. Any questions or clarification before I go ahead? Anything that you want to ask? Yeah. Because I cut across a huge topic, actually speaking. Because I'm using words, finite words, to reveal the truth. But remember, when I'm using finite words to reveal the truth, it is not piling up of adjectives. Atma is Sachidananda. But it is not adjectives. The more you pile on adjectives, the more finite you make it. Look at the. I'm introducing you to a little bit about how teaching in Vedanta takes place. You know. Look at it. You're keeping quiet. I'm quiet now. My mind is pregnant with infinite possibilities, isn't it? Infinity fills up my mind. Then I utter one word, pen. What has happened? All non-pens have gone out. Meaning the sun and the moon and the stars and the trees and the lake and birds and bees and people. All of them has gone out because I said pen. One word, pen. But pen is also huge. Then I put another adjective to that pen. A gel pen. Then ballpoints, fountain, all that thing goes out. From the world of pens, so many things have gone out. Just gel pen, one subset. One more word. A black gel pen. So all blue and red and green and yellow, all that is gone out. Then I say one more adjective. Uniball, make. Again, all the 100 makes have gone out. You see, I'm making it more finite. Then I give a location, the one in my pocket. So from the infinite possibilities, the more adjectives I added, what happened? Shrunk it to one. So when you're talking about the Atma, we are not adding adjectives. Satyam, Jnanam, Anantam are not three adjectives of Brahman. It is Brahman. That consciousness itself is existence. That consciousness itself is limitlessness. Anantam is limitless. It's one thing, you. But this is different from me. What about that? You want me to handle it now? Or handle it tomorrow? What is it? You tell me, because I have 20 minutes. A lot of time. Now? Okay. Let us take anything in the world. What is there in my pocket? Okay. What is this? A sheet of paper. Correct? What is the truth behind this paper? This piece of paper. Let's look at the truth behind it.
It was created.
Huh?
It was created.
Wood pulp or something like that? They'll be made from something like that, right? So, the truth behind it, the content of it, is wood pulp. But wood pulp can be anything. It can be a figure. It can be a book. It can be. So, what we call this paper, the sheet of, single sheet of paper, is one form of wood pulp. So, when I am looking at what the object is, the object has disappeared into a form. The reality is wood pulp. Okay, let me look at what is wood pulp. Wood pulp looks like an object. Is it? It's an arrangement of hydrocarbons. Wood pulp is one arrangement of hydrocarbons. This body is another arrangement of hydrocarbons. The tree is also hydrocarbons. The grass is also hydrocarbons. So, lot of forms of hydrocarbons. So, wood pulp, the object, has become a form, disappeared into the content, hydrocarbons. But hydrocarbon is a molecule. Molecule is an arrangement of atoms. So the hydrocarbon has become a form, object hydrocarbon has disappeared into a form. What is left is atoms. But an atom is made up of particles, three fundamental ones. So atom is a form, an arrangement of particles. The particle itself is an arrangement of further particles. How long will we keep going? Because everything is becoming form. Anything that you say as an object is being resolved into its content, and the object has become a form. So what will have to be the final thing? You can't say nothing. Why? Why you can't say nothing? Because I am discussing about this sheet of paper that is there with me. This is something. This is not nothing. From nothing, nothing will come. There is something. That means what? There is an existence, because this is existing. The wood pulp is existing. The hydrocarbon is existing. The atom is existing. The particles are existing. There is an existence without a form. Because if there is a form, I'll resolve it into something else. Formless existence is the basis of this paper, the basis of this solid thing, the basis of the tree and the sun and the moon and the stars. Satyam. You can negate a form, but the final thing that cannot be negated is called Satyam, existence, pure existence. So what is the limit of pure existence? That's also unconditioned by time and space. Does time exist? So existence. Space exists. Truth has to be formless existence. Space is pretty close because it's formless. So formless existence out there. Now, am I the consciousness different from existence? Let us assume it's different. Then I'll become non-existent. Why? I'm other than existence, no? Hey, that's not true. I'm existing, all right. I see the form. The form doesn't see me. Therefore, what we call as formless existence is nothing but consciousness. If it is formless, unconditioned, limitless, it is also anantam, satyam jnanam anantam. The Upanishad is not silent, it is very eloquent here. It's not silent, it's talking all about a lot of things. Traditional teaching explains that. Yeah, it is a pure consciousness, which is existence, which is limitless. Therefore, three words are not three adjectives. Three words are referring to one and the same thing. Those who listen to traditional Vedanta, Samanadikarnyam, the process of representing all things as one. Different words but referring to one and the same thing. But not in an adjectival sense. Because adjective, remember the pen. From the infinite thing, I came down to one small object. It's not adjectives. It is the unfoldment of what is your limitless consciousness. Not limited by anything. You are the truth behind this whole universe. The world is too small to make you feel small. The world is too small to make you feel big goals. Because you can't get bigger than yourself anyway. And this is what the learning is about. So the whole learning in the Gita, the Upanishad, etc. is all about coming to this, understanding this, making it your own, making it real, freeing it from doubts, freeing it from your conditionings, your knowledge free from conditioning. Therefore, if you are a yogi before, you have an unconditioned mind anyway. You will absorb it faster. That's why yoga and Vedanta go together. That's why there are yoga Upanishads. Upanishads dealing with yoga. Upanishads dealing with yoga. Very often they connect Sankhya and yoga together. In modern world, Sankhya and yoga is connected. But in the older tradition, the more ancient tradition, the Upanishads dealt with yoga. So why the Sankhya came in, etc. Maybe when I'm clarifying tomorrow about moksha, the idea of moksha, which I've already half covered here. So this will flow into what I'm doing. And how do you live after you gain this knowledge? Some of those doubts came up in the morning as well. How do you live? In one short form? Teachers, traditional teachers in Rishikesh will say that. Live like the other fools around you. Meaning, live normal. But I will clarify those things, okay? So, words are doing the trick. Vedanta is nothing but words. But we are aware of the tyranny that words can create. The concepts that the words can create. So we break them. We break them. So a teacher is nothing but who knows how to use that words to reveal the truth. There are various ways of doing it. There are various this thing. Each Upanishad is a methodology. Yeah. So by the time you study half an Upanishad, your mind is fine. Okay. You study the Gita, you learn how to know and how to live, and then you study this. So Gita also tells you about preparing the mind. The Vedantic way of doing the same yoga thing. All that I will talk more maybe tomorrow. So if there any questions, shoot. We have 10 minutes to go. Yes, sir.
What is the argument against consciousness not being a form of something else?
Different from something else?
Not being a form of, you've done the paper is a form of wood pulp.
No, sorry, I'm not getting that.
So you said paper is a form of wood pulp.
Yeah.
Could consciousness not be a form of something else?
What can it be a form? Because that doubt comes in. Because the word in English language, the word consciousness, is used, and all over the West in modern science, consciousness is seen as a product of the brain, as a product of matter. One of the biggest thing in science is consciousness is a product of matter. the information arranging activity of the brain is looked upon as consciousness. In other words, knowledge is looked upon as consciousness. Now, I'm telling you something right now, okay? Listen to this carefully. It'll be a very interesting exercise. What is this? It's a pen. You know this pen. In your mind, there is knowledge of the pen. Are you conscious of the fact that you know this pen? The first conscious of this pen was a product of your mind, brain. The second one, because now you're objectifying your mind and brain. When I said, are you conscious of the fact you know this? You're taking a step back into what you are and you're objectifying your brain, your mind. Can you see what's happening? Try. Are you conscious of the fact you know this pen? Yeah. So, are you in meditation or are you watching the pen? There's no difference. This is it. All the time. So, this second consciousness is not... the consciousness of my mind can be resolved into myself. You know, we have an old example that we use, traditional example. Why is the water hot? Because water in a natural condition is not hot. Oh, because the pot is hot. Why is the pot hot? Because the fire is hot. There's a fire burning below. Fire. Why is the fire hot? You can ask it only if there is cold fire. Similarly, my mind is conscious. Why? My body, let's start. My body is conscious because there's a mind in it. If I knock off that mind-body connection through anesthesia or deep sleep, you're not conscious of the body. Mosquitoes are feeding on your body, you don't know it once you're deep sleep. Until then, you're aware of it, not then, after you have slept. Correct? So, your body is conscious because the mind, conscious mind filling up this body. Your mind is conscious because I am conscious. Why am I conscious? Is there any time when I am not conscious? Even when I am in deep sleep, how do you get up in the morning and say you slept? How do you do it? Are you getting up in the morning and inferring? Between this time, I did not know anything. Therefore, I must have been asleep. Or do you say, hey, I slept well. It's direct memory. That means you are there. That means you are conscious of the sleeping mind. You were there. But when you get up, you say, I slept, because you are identified with the mind. Remember that actor. You are identified with the mind when you get up and say, I slept. But you were there. Even in unconsciousness, it's the same thing. In samadhi, it's the same thing. So there is an anda samadhi, there is jnana samadhi. Those things I will clarify tomorrow. So consciousness is always, there's never a time when you are not conscious. So there's no resolving point because you're always consciousness. But the consciousness of the brain can be resolved. The consciousness of the mind can be resolved into me. I consciousness, there's no, that's the final state, satyam. That's the final state, satyam, limitlessness. This is me. Then why don't I feel it? All that, that's moksha out of it. That part I split and left it for tomorrow. Yeah, 10 minutes to go. I hope I'm not putting people closer towards unconscious state, you know. I was afraid I may go into it, so I had a cup of coffee before I came. Because I can't afford to sleep in my own class, you know. Others can afford to sleep. I can't. Yeah.
You were talking about adjectives and the importance of words.
Yeah.
And is there a problem in using the word you as in you are consciousness?
No.
Isn't it not more appropriate to say there is consciousness?
No. In fact, the teaching is your consciousness, no? Your pure consciousness, unlimited by anything. Anantam. Anantam, the word is unlimited. Okay, another word, ananda. In the English literature is very often translated as bliss. Personally, in the tradition, we don't like that word bliss so much. Because bliss doesn't communicate. What is bliss? A hot drink on a cold day or a cold drink on a hot day, both are blissful experiences. I was with my girlfriend, it was blissful. So what is bliss? It can be, don't take it literally, I'm giving an example, okay? At this stage, we don't have girlfriends, so okay. So it was just an example. So that bliss is a very subjective word. It doesn't communicate. So it is an indicative word. What is an indicative word? When you feel joyful, what are you really pointing out to? What is that experience being pointing out to? So ananda is used to indicate that. Through your happiness, it is pointing out the state of fullness that you are. So the word ananda is used in an implied sense, not in a direct sense. The original word in the Upanishad is anantam. Satyam jnanam anantam. Limitlessness. So then that limitlessness wells up in my mind, I'm happy. Ananda. Let's say every monk is called ananda. He's supposed to be that. Either joking and laughing and ananda, or serious class ananda, or empathizing with grief, but ananda in then is supposed to be. So that owning up is moksha. That I will elaborate tomorrow more, how to go about it, how to do it. So you get the roadmap clear. But the most important thing is that shravanam, listening. Because words, letting the words work their magic in your mind. Words can do that. As long as you can let the mind go along the words and not go here and there. That's where the discipline comes. You can let go. A lot of yoga is about letting go, isn't it? Yeah. So you go along, let the mind go along the words, knowledge will take place. If the teaching is traditional, it has to take place. How can you be so sure? Here. There's an object of knowledge, pen. Your pramana eyes are there. The mind is backing the eyes. Can you deny yourself the knowledge of pen? If you're looking at this, your eyes are functioning. You, the knower, is there. The object of knowledge is there. The pramana, means of knowledge, eyes are there. How can you deny yourself the knowledge? It happens. That's why when you travel, etc., sometimes you see things you don't want to see. You can't help it. So the knower, I am there. The student who wants to learn. What you want to know, the self, the subject, I, is very much there. The pramana, the means of knowledge, the Upanishad, the teaching is available. Why should knowledge not take place? Swamiji, I can't see very clearly. I need glasses. So you need some fine-tuning of the mind. That's all. That's yoga. Once you do that, you cannot but gain the knowledge. If you are exposed to traditional teaching, you will gain it. It's not as difficult as it looks. It looks, oh my God, I am infinite, etc. So what's the big deal? Then I'll be a wise person. Yeah, yeah. You'll discover what a fool you were before. I did all this thing just to get back to myself. Come on, yeah. It's so simple. That's why all of us don't take our robes too seriously. Others take, but we don't take our robes too seriously. Okay. Just a uniform. No big deal. Yeah, it's simple. You are not different from me. You are me if you just pending discovery. That's all. That's all you need to know. That's it. If I can do it, so can you. Oh, I'm a monk from this. Yeah, all that is fine. Another time and another place. That's all. I've gone through a certain system. That's all. Yeah, I was born with the same thing, with the same desires, same things as all of you were. Been through the same life that all of you have been. Yeah, I can do it, so can you. Why can you not do it? Of course you can. Have that healthy self-esteem to yourself that, hey, if that guy can give it, so can I. Not me speaking, it's the Gita speaking, okay? Udhared atmanatmanam natmanam avasadayet. Lift yourself by yourself, don't look down upon yourself. Have that confidence to do it. There's no way you cannot get it. Of course, like I was blessed with traditional teaching, you need that. That traditional is not whether you are wearing the robes or not. I would be the same if I was wearing a three-piece suit or t-shirt and track pants. I would be the same. Sorry, not track pants, yoga pants. I would be the same. I mean, in what way am I different? That's not the tradition. Tradition is how you handle the words, etc. How you handle the words to reveal the truth. That is what transduction, what is passed on by word of mouth. That is tradition, knowledge. So once you know that, there's no way none of you can get it. So moksha, here I come tomorrow. The final part. Okay. Om Tat Sat.